Now that WWDC is less than 60 days away, I want to hear what you're wishing for, what you're hoping for. Majid here shares his wishes, and at the top of the list is better AI tooling from Apple. He says the rapid pace of AI advancements in products like ChatGPT, Cursor, GitHub Copilot, it's undeniable. Like web developers, Android developers can all enjoy that tooling and build features at a very high pace. Unfortunately, just not the case for us native iOS developers. And this can be a pretty big deal, especially for maybe newer developers coming in the space. They may just avoid native altogether to use these tools, right? Looks like we already reached a critical point where developers considering switching to React Native plus Expo or even Flutter just to take advantage of that AI tooling. So I agree with Majid. I would definitely love to see whether it's Swift Assist or something else, better AI tooling straight from Apple. And now I don't think these, you know, React Native, Flutter apps can compete with the upper echelon of native iOS apps, right? The best of the best, the Apple Design Award winners. Just for discussion's sake, let's call it the top 10% of apps. So if that's the app you're trying to build, that's what you're going for, I think you got a pretty good competitive advantage. But that still leaves like 90% of all the other apps that these cross-platform apps can compete with, and they have way better tooling. So come on, Apple, let's get some good AI tooling to help us native developers out. Now we do have Alex Sidebar out there, which is great, but you know, some first-party stuff from Apple would be huge. So that's just it on the AI tooling front. That's what I would like to see. I would also like to see, well, we're probably gonna get that big iOS 19 redesign, right? That's gonna be a big deal. That's gonna keep us very busy over the summer. So because of that, I just would like to see stability, bug fixes. Like, I don't need a lot of new features, new SwiftUI stuff. Just, hey, fix the stuff that's already there, make it run great, and then let us deal with the redesign and give us some AI tooling. That's my dream WWDC. We'll see if we get that or any of it. What do you think? What are you hoping for from WWDC this year? So even though I'm looking for better AI tooling from Apple, I do want to share this article, Why I Stopped Using AI Code Editors. I know, it's a contradiction. But it was thought-provoking, and here's the TLDR, the too long didn't read. I chose to make using AI a manual action because I felt the slow loss of competence over time when I relied on it. And I recommend everyone be cautious with making AI a key part of their workflow. And that's the gist of the article, is that over time you just become reliant on it and you forget to do things. The analogy he gives here is Tesla full self-driving. He talks about, you know, when you'd be on the highway, just puts the Tesla in full self-driving mode, doesn't have to think about it, it's great, awesome. But then when he sold that car and got a different car, now we had to manually drive on the highway. And he says, making the switch was definitely not what I expected. Driving on the highway required my full attention for the first month or so. I had to relearn keeping the car in the middle of the lane without thinking about it. Because if you've driven for a long time, right, like driving is just on autopilot for our brains. And that's what he compares coding to when you're experienced in a language, a code editor. You just have this intuition. You know the language, you know your tools, and you're just moving quickly. And that's what he talks about like losing by relying too much on AI code editors. Here he says, I felt less competent, which that always sucks, right? This is your profession and you start to feel less competent. That's never a good feeling. So I felt less competent at doing what was quite basic software development. All of a sudden, it made me very clear how reliant I'd become on AI tools. And I bet we've all kind of experienced this next phenomenon right here if you've used these tools. Anytime I defined a function, I paused and waited for the AI tool to complete the code, right? You're just tab, tab, tab. What? You're not even like thinking, you're just tabbing cool. And while that does increase productivity and speed you up, that's great. I think it's undeniable that over time, over the long run, your skills will atrophy if you're just waiting for the AI editor to complete your code. Now, of course, there's the argument, and this is why I wanted to share this, because I can see both sides. It's like, you know, do we still need to know how to do long division when there's calculators and computers everywhere? Does this even matter that you forget how to do this if you can just guide the computer to do it? I would argue, yes, it does, but I can also see the argument for, hey, you're not even gonna need this skill in 5 to 10 years. And he continues to go on and talk about the loss of finger spitz and toggle. Right. Anyway, it's a German term, obviously, where it's just that intuition we talked about. You're used to using your language, your Xcode, all that stuff, and you just kind of fly through things. You just lose that intuition after a while of relying on AI tools. And he talks about how you can get by without these tools, because how I use AI, I haven't fully dove into like the cursors, the Alex sidebars, all that stuff, where the tab, tab, tab coding. I use ChatGPT all day, every day, you know, and I kind of copy and paste over or have it apply code, whatever, but I haven't really experienced the full tab, tab, tab coding yet. And it's articles like these that make me a little hesitant, but I do believe in like LLMs using ChatGPT to help solve a problem, right? There's nothing like copying and pasting some obscure Xcode error that is gibberish to you and ChatGPT is like, oh yeah, do this, this, and this and fix it. Like, that's amazing. But yeah, I'm curious to hear your experience with the tab, tab, tab coding and if you feel like your skills are atrophying. But there's a couple more things I wanted to share in this article. Scrolling down, doing what you love, This is, I do agree with this, but I don't know if this is like a good sole argument, right? It's worth noting that there's much more things to think about than how fast you can code and how productive you are, right? If you love coding, like do what you love. Don't let the AI do it for you. I think there's some validity to that. But the last thing I want to share is the advice to new programmers. Don't become a forever junior who lets AI do all their work. If you want to be a programmer, learn to program yourself. And I think I was watching a Y Combinator podcast where they hypothesized, you know, there'll be a pretty good market for good enough engineers. And those are the engineers that can, you know, use AI, guide AI to get stuff done, but they might not fully understand how all the code works. And that's fine. They'll probably make decent money. But then there's going to be this tier of programmers, engineers that really understand the code, don't rely on AI, and they like know how it all works, and they're probably going to clean up the AI's mess. Those are going to be the highly sought after, highly paid senior engineers. So I believe what they mean by becoming a forever junior is if you never learn the skill set, you just tab, 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 let AI write all the code, you never fully understand what's going on, you're probably gonna stay in that good enough engineer bucket. Hey, that might be good enough for you. But I'll leave it with this quote, which is from DHH from another interview. It says, believe me, it's just more fun to be competent. Next up, we have an article from Danny here in the SwiftUI Craftsmanship series of state management. This is a vital skill when working with SwiftUI because everything relies on state. It says it right here. In SwiftUI, everything is driven by state. Every user interaction, every update, every transition causes a reaction to the state we define. So this article is going to be about keeping your state minimal to reduce complexity and not get bloated views where you're having performance issues. So what is this minimal state here, right? This is the key guiding principle for state management. What is the minimal state needed to keep the UI accurate and responsive? And this is like per view. By considering this question, we aim to simplify our approach, ensure that we aren't bogged down by unnecessary complexity and performance issues. By identifying the minimal set of states, we can avoid bloated views and improve performance, resulting in a more responsive and maintainable app. And the rest of the article goes on to share a little bit of code, some basic examples of how we're building out the state and how even, you know, two state properties can cause a, you know, complex, I'll scroll down to it. I guess this isn't like crazy complex, but this is the state diagram for just two state properties on a view. Again, not crazy complex, but I'm sure most of your SwiftUI views might have 7, 8, 9, 10 state properties. I'm sure you've built some views like that. And that's the overall gist of this article. It walks you through how you can think about keeping that minimal state so you can get back to a core fundamental principle of SwiftUI that I want to repeat because myself included, I think a lot of us forget this, is when you first learn SwiftUI, you first read like the opening paragraph of the SwiftUI docs, it says, keep your views small, lightweight, and use composition to take those smaller views and build a much larger view or screen. Like that is something you learn like day one, SwiftUI 101, but I think a lot of us forget it. Like I know I built some SwiftUI views recently that have a lot of state that I can definitely break those up into smaller views. And again, you reduce complexity, which also reduces these huge bloated views, which can also help performance in SwiftUI apps. Moving on, we have the great app that nobody knows about from Jordan Morgan. And this boils down to one of the biggest problems we have as indie developers or just developers in general. We typically suck at marketing our apps, and we also underestimate the value of marketing, right? We put all of our effort into building a beautiful, amazing app. And that's what Jordan says here. You might have a fantastic app sitting at 1 or 2 downloads a day. You're probably thinking that it's deserving of a bit more, right? Unfortunately, this is where he sees the story end with far too many talented indie devs. A great app that nobody knows about is still a great app that nobody knows about. And this article basically sings the praises of marketing. And it's not going to be that one more feature that finally catches on and gets all your users. No, you have to tell people about it to like what will feel like an obnoxious degree. And Jordan talks about his marketing efforts with Elite Hoops. And by the way, I love following this thread from Jordan here. Talks about his milestones. He hit 500 MRR, monthly recurring revenue, for the app back on November 12th, 2023. So about a year and a half ago. But he's been posting these milestones every $500. So a few weeks later, hit 1,000, 1,500, 2,000, 2,500, 3,000, 3,500, right? You can see all the way up to, I think now he's at, as of April 1st, 6,000. And you can see it took him 544 days since launch to get to 6,000 monthly recurring revenue. But you can check out the since last milestone, 11 days, 16 days, 14 days, right? It's like speeding up as time goes on, right? It's like a flywheel that starts to take off. But he says back in this article, none of this happens if you don't get out there and market your app, right? You can try paid acquisition with your expendable income. It says, even if it's $10 a day for a few months, like try it, you'll learn a lot. I love this idea. Commit to marketing for a month instead of developing. Like stop building that next feature. Stop fixing bugs. Just put Xcode down and do nothing but market your app. And down here, post, post, post. Like you don't have to have some crazy Apple looking marketing. Like Just simply you using your app, showing off what it does, you know, the best parts of it, and posting it is a good step forward in like learning that marketing skill. Because when you're an indie, like you have to be just as much of a marketer as you are a developer. And you probably sucked at development when you first started, is what Jordan says here. You're probably gonna suck at marketing when you first started, but now you're probably a pretty good programmer. So in time, you can probably be a pretty good marketer too. And speaking of making money from apps, like not all monetization is good monetization. And this article from RevenueCat is basically, what are some of the bad practices that may earn you a little bit of revenue in the short term, but is actually going to hurt you in the long term? And a lot of these things are like borderline unethical, but we're gonna review the list real quick. So the five principles of ethical monetization: transparent communication, which basically means just be clear about your payment plans. Don't try and trick the user into like buying something. Value-driven freemium models. You've ever downloaded an app that says this is free, but then you get in there and like every feature is paid. It's like, okay, it's really not free. So don't do that. Respectful marketing, ethical free trials. Don't try to deceptively get someone to sign up for a free trial and then just hope they don't cancel the free trial or hope they forget. And this article digs deeper into those concepts with examples. Don't use dark patterns. They give the example of Amazon's unsubscribe feature, how they would like make it really hard to cancel and shame you into canceling. Avoid constantly interrupting content with ads. Like, yes, you can make a lot of money with ads, but also don't destroy the user experience. Again, you might make short-term money, but if you're trying to build a long-term business, none of these are the way to go. And if you have kids playing games on iPads, I'm sure you've seen this. Well, they'll play the game for like a minute or two and then get hit with 2 minutes of ads. Play the game for a minute or two, hit with ads. It's like, it's absurd what they do to these kids' apps. But anyway, this article just continues to highlight examples of, you know, the bad practice. Again, be careful in the way that your product presents a free trial. They show the Blinkist paywall. If you're not familiar with this, this is an example of being like ethical, but like, hey, you're gonna start a free trial today. In 5 days, we're gonna send you a notification to remind you, hey, if you wanna cancel, cancel. And then in 7 days, you'll be charged. Like, this is a good example of just clearly stating to the user what's going to happen. Whereas a lot of apps, they just say, sign up for the free trial. If you forget to cancel, that's on you. And again, there's more examples through this article. So definitely go give it a read to make sure you're not doing any of these bad practices so you can build a long-lasting app business. That does it for this week's Swift News. See you in the next one.